Juan Garcia is a prisoner in Texas. If the state has its way, he'll be dead within the hour. This is Execution Watch. Huntsville, Texas, death penalty capital of the Western world. Where prison staff is preparing to put Garcia to death by injecting him with a deliberate drug overdose. During the next hour, KPFT's Execution Watch will broadcast live coverage of the killing in Texas, the state responsible for more than a third of all U.S. executions. Execution Watch host Ray Hill, chief legal analyst Jim Skelton, with legal analysts Susan Ashley, Larry Douglas, Jack Lee, and Mike Gillespie. Huntsville reporter outside the death house, Pratt Hartwell. Houston Vigil reporter, Jennifer Simmons. The show will feature Execution Watch's unedited 20-minute interview with Garcia. The Execution Watch for Juan Garcia begins. Don't you know they're killing people? Don't you know they're killing people? Don't you know they're killing people?
Good evening, this is Ray Hill. It is execution day in Texas. Those of you who normally listen to this show understand that none of us want to be here, but we are here because you were there, and this is the closest you can possibly get to the execution of Juan Garcia. Juan is interviewed in this show, and at the appropriate time, we will play that interview. And when this show is over, Mark Pirtle will take both the videotape of that interview and the videotape of this show, splice them together, and they will be available for broadcast on Houston Media Source. That's hmstv.org. at a later date, and then they will be ensconced on the website for Execution Watch. We have Pat, who is in Huntsville. Pat, are you there?
Yes, I am.
What is going on?
I'm sorry, I can hardly hear you.
Across
the road, there were about five media witnesses and three of his family, his sister, a niece, and a brother-in-law to witness tonight. His family is out here, his three children, along with his other sister, Alex, and some family friends and some nieces and nephews. We have about 20 abolitionists out here and some Sam Houston students who are learning what the state of Texas is all about.
Okay, Pat, number one, give our regards to the vigilance and tell them that keep up the good work.
Yes, I will, and I will give your condolences to the family. Tonight, when we ring the bell 15 times, one for each year that Juan has been there, we will read a poem called Goodbye by Eugene Broxton that I think is appropriate.
Well, I'm glad that is getting to be a little ceremony on the occasion there. But he's got family in town, so I need to tell the audience that when this process is over, his body will be carried to a nearby chapel for a private viewing with the family, wrapped only in a sheet. The family will be able to touch the body while it is still warm.
Yes, you might add that we have to rush over there because this will be the first time that he has been touched in 18 years because he spent several years in the county and 15 on death row. So this is the first opportunity the family will have to touch him.
Thank you, Pat. Appreciate what you do. It'll keep
Thank
us informed
you,
of what goes on up there.
Okay.
All right. And so while we wait to connect to a demonstration here in Houston, I understand Dave Atwood is with a vigil here. Jim?
Yes.
This is not a pretty case.
It's a real bad case. What happened on this particular day, Juan Garcia and a couple of cousins and another guy were on a robbery spree. They've been on a robbery spree for a couple of months.
apparently they did that a good bit.
A lot of it. In fact, that day they had done three robberies. This was the third one that day. And this was what you'd call a random robbery because they were just driving by an apartment complex and saw this Hispanic man getting into his van, and they just decided to rob him. And he'd lived here. He just moved here about a month. He'd been a missionary in Guadalajara, and he moved here because his child could get a better education. He was some like 36-year-old man, and he was getting in his van to go to work or getting to coming home from work, and they rushed up to him, and Garcia had a 25-caliber pistol, and he demanded the man money from the man. The man refused to give him any money, so he shot him four times, three times in the head, once in the neck, and killed him. And they got a grand total of $8 out of it. Anyway,
they shot him how many times?
Four times. Three times in the head. He's only 25 caliber.
The bullets cost more than the money they got.
I know that. And then thereafter, the next few days, they committed more robberies until he was finally caught. And there's very little you can say about this case. Michael's going to talk about his background.
Was this a gang? Oh, okay.
Well, he was a member of a gang as a child. And this were two cousins. And I'll tell you what happened to the other. The other two cousins, one of them got a life sentence. One of them got a 55-year sentence. And the nun's cousin, I think, got a 35-year sentence. He's currently paroled. But he was the only one out of the group that got the death penalty. And only two of them went to trial. He got death by going to trial. The other cousin got life by going to trial, and then one of the cousins testified against everybody else, and he came out with a 55-year sentence for robbery. And then they let the other guy, who was kind of a hang-along, he got like a 35-year sentence, spent 14 years in the joint. He's currently paroled.
How old were these people?
They were 18 and 19, real young kids.
Yeah.
Because apparently, Ray answered your gang question. He had been a member of a gang. I think Michael talked about that. He was a member of a gang when he was real young. In fact, he started getting in trouble really at the age of 9 or 10. This is not his first rodeo.
And he went on this case in when he was 18?
Right, when he was 18.
And the Supreme Court of the United States has said anyone who commits a crime after their 18th birthday can be executed. But if you commit the crime when you're 364 days, 17 years old, you can't be executed.
That's right. He was just barely above the mark. And something like this, though, the truth of the matter is, since they were doing nothing but robberies on a robbery spree, and apparently they're spending all their money on drugs, he later claimed he was high on this occasion. And it is inevitable someone's going to eventually get killed.
Yeah, in this case,
right.
The prognosis is not good.
No.
If he had survived this execution, the prognosis is not good because this is the only lifestyle he knew.
Right. He'd been in trouble since the only time he wasn't in trouble was when he was a fetus. And that's about the only time he wasn't in trouble. Otherwise, he stayed in trouble all the time. In fact, he fathered, I think, two or three kids when he was a teenager.
Yeah, he talks about it in the interview. He talks about kids that were born before he was 15 years old.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's... I'm trying to put that in the context that me and... Because you know, I'm no angel. I've been around the block a time here. I've been to prison. I've been some other things. But I'm trying to put that into the context that I can understand it given my life experience, and I can't do that, Jim.
There's a thing. There's a thing called gang mentality. That individually, people won't do things they'll do in a gang. And when you get a group of three kids high on drugs, really four people high on drugs, just two cousins, another guy and them,
yeah,
and they'll pump each other up. And as a matter of fact, if you recall the famous In Cold Blood killing, Truman Capote,
sure.
The psychiatrist at Menninger's claimed that neither man alone would have done the killing, but the combination of the two personalities created a third psychological being that did the killing.
I had met Truman Capote once, so I followed the whole process. Truman actually fell in love with the younger fellow.
Oh, no.
And he set out to write the book to prove that the younger fellow was being led by the older fellow, and it turned out to be the other way around.
Just the opposite.
Just the opposite.
But they say the psychiatrist that examined them claimed that the combination of their personalities created, neither the person alone would have done it. And you'll often find this when kids get together, 18-year-old kids, and start hyping each other up. They'll do things in a group they would not do individually. And that's what makes it so dangerous, because when they're out robbing and spending all their money on drugs, it's inevitable someone's going to eventually get killed. And it just happened to be this poor guy. As a matter of fact, the guy that killed, I'll say, was a former missionary. He'd come back to the States to let his child get an education here. So, anyway, Michael will tell you more about his background.
All right, what's up next, Mike? Michael, is there anything in your experience that helps you understand this guy?
Yeah, a lot.
Okay.
A lot. Sometimes in life, you never catch a break. This is a boy who was born in 1980. He was born without knowing the father.
Yeah.
He was born with a stepfather who routinely beat him. Allegations the stepfather was arrested for sex abuse of young girls in the family. He was uneducated. He was not able to read or write till he was an adult. He was a boy with no direction, with nobody to help him out. The system failed him. You'd like to think that in that situation, CPS would have gotten involved and taken him out of that environment, but nobody did.
CPS is not as attentive to minority families living in trailer parks in villages from Honduras and El Salvador as they are in River Oaks neighborhoods.
And the reason they are is because white babies they can adopt out. Non-white babies are stuck in the system. They have to support them. So what you said is very true, Ray. There is, if you're white and you're in CPS contact, your chance of being taken away is much more than if you're not a white person. But this kid, if you look at the way he grew up, he never had a chance. By the time he was 9 years old, he was making terroristic threats. By the time he was 9 years old, you're talking about born in 1980, by 1990, he was already running the streets. He was, in his mind, true or not, the sole support, the spine of his family. He was the one that his mother needed in order to help. He considered himself a Robin Hood, that he had to go out and break into cars and steal rims and radios and pawn them to help his mother and family survive. Now, right or wrong, that's the mentality of a young, young boy who's doing the only thing that he knows is taking care of his family. Now, you can't justify what he did, but there is a mentality called gang mentality. And what that means is that we all want to talk about gangs as being bad, but it's inborn in young males to want to belong to a group of other young males to prove their worth. Some people join Little League Baseball, Little Conference Football. They joined the
band.
This
kid didn't have time for baseball.
He was too busy supporting his mind, supporting his family. Then you got the extra problem that he started doing drugs. Now, opiums. Don't know exactly what he did. They tend to always put all drugs together as a group.
Yeah, basically what he get his hands on.
But who knows what he was doing? There wasn't long ago that a young boy smoking tobacco was considered to be doing drugs. We don't know what he was doing. But he was stealing, he was robbing, he was doing these things. And if you look at his criminal record, all he has in the system is at 12, a terroristic threat, and at 13, a simple theft. Where's the authorities? Where's the people out there trying to protect people to take him out of this home life? There was nobody there for him. And so what happens is by the time he becomes 18, when this happens, he's now running with boys of his own age, his cousins, and they're out there for a two-week period. From August 31st to September 17th, we've got 7 aggravated robberies.
7 aggravated in 2 weeks.
You got 3
those
in one day.
Those folks are working long days.
You got 3 in one day.
Yeah, I get a little cranky when I have to work a long day.
He was arrested on one of them and released on bond. At what point of time do you not release somebody like that? You release him back to a home like that, to an environment like that, to a stepfather that beat you, to a mother that you need to support? he says, and I believe him, that even though he did not feel he was that bad, his reputation was such that he never got a chance, that nobody would give him a job, that nobody would give him respect because he looked that bad, and because he would work, he would look sweaty and dirty. Well, sweaty and dirty from work is not the same thing as being a bad person, but he never got a chance. So the only chance he had, the only thing he did, was rely upon his gang, his group, of which some of them are family members. Two of them are cousins.
It's a considerable luxury to get up and shower before you go to work. Most really working people shower when they get home from work.
They don't talk at this. We don't know about his home life, but I wonder how many bedrooms there was in the house. I wonder if there were beds. I wonder if there were clothes. I wonder about the food. You have to wonder about all these things. He talks about how he felt that he was the spine of his family, that he was the one that held the family together. He might have been. At least in his mind, he was. And the end result of all of this is now, once he was arrested and given the death penalty, at 18, 19 years old, he has now been into an environment where he's been supervised. Yes, he got in one fight in the county jail and got a misdemeanor assault. But he also found religion. He became a Catholic. You hear his interview, you're going to see he's a changed person.
Why don't we do that? One thing I want to say.
It just seems to me that the time to judge whether a man should be executed is not in the heat and the passion of the crime, but just before the needle goes in. After 15 years in prison, when you have a chance to reflect on your sins, change yourself, it seems to be that should be the time where we should judge a man or whether he should be killed to be redeemed or not. This is not about punishment. It's about forgiveness. We're a Christian society. As a Christian society, our code is forgiveness. We're not giving a person a chance to change. We're punishing him in the heat of the motion based upon what he was. If the death penalty needs to be, it needs to be done and judged at the time, at the end, to see what he became. Because I think after people listen to his video, they'll see that maybe this was a life that was wasted.
Well, we're going to get a chance to look at him shortly. But the producer has found, I think, a journalist to be part of the show. Christopher Simmons is trying to get her on the line. Let me see Elizabeth's notes. She just pointed out to you. Okay, here we go. And we're going to get a response from Jennifer Simmons, who is actually Texas Coalition Against the Death Penalty, if she can be found on the telephone. And then when we get through with brief conversation with Jennifer, we're going to go on to the interview with Juan. I interviewed Juan, and I found the interview very telling. He talks mostly about his wife and the saga of a young outlaw convincing a potential mother-in-law that that he needed. That she would accept him as a son-in-law. Well, I don't see any telephone lighting coming on, so let's go ahead, and I don't know what to do here, and we don't have, okay. Where is the cassette? Is there? Here we go.
Well, how close is it?
Well, to be honest with you, I've lost count of the days, but it's... I would say approximately maybe 3.5 weeks away.
Okay, October 6th?
Yes, sir.
My birthday's October the 13th. I hope we're both still alive and laughing about it.
Me too. You know, the bad thing is my wife, her birthday is the very next day, October the 7th.
Well, we got enough here in October, right? We ought to go to Germany and drink a little beer and still go through this foolishness.
Well,
tell me about your wife.
Well, we met in a very awkward situation, and when we got together, it was basically boyfriend and girlfriend. My mom's family's older sister's kids, my cousins, they didn't like the girlfriend that I had, and they didn't like the lifestyle I was living because they could never find me. I didn't like none of my family to know my other life. So I would always split.
Yeah,
and so they came and picked me up at my sister's house, older sister's house, and they took me to go live with them. So when I'm living with them, you know, I'm living way over there in out of city limits. Well, and where we lived at, it was on the street, on the main street. On this side is out of city limits. On this side, you're in the city limits. So we lived in a trailer inside of city limits. And so I asked my cousin one day, she told us we needed to clean on a weekend, clean a yard, because owner of the trailer was telling us that, you know, we can do some landscaping. And so we did some tidying up, some landscaping, and so I'm out there, and I asked my older cousin, I asked him, hey, man, where's the girls at, man? You know, I wasn't used to just being single. And he said, well, there's a few walking, you know, every from time to time. There ain't no sidewalks out there. Yeah. And so I see these chicks. There was three of them, and I hollered at my whistle, and what's up? So they said, we're going to the store, we'll be back. So they take off, and me and my other cousin, well, he's my little sister's, his parents are my little sister's godparents. So, you know, when they finally come back, me and him, we were talking that, I bet you I can get this girl. No, I bet you I get this girl. Well, long story short, I met her, I got her phone number, and from that day forward, we've been together.
A couple.
And we were
born. She from El Salvador, too?
Yes. Okay. Well, see, I'm from here.
You're from here?
I'm from here. She's from El Salvador. She's been here, if I'm not mistaken, I think she had been here since she was 8 years old. And 2010, there was a funeral or something. She told me in her letter that there was a funeral that she had to attend to, and she had a immigration court hearing.
Mm-hmm.
So she felt like immigration court hearing would have not, you know, do anything about it, you know, that they would understand. So she went to the funeral and missed the court hearing. So a couple of days later, they picked her up on a citation. I guess she passed a red light.
Because my other field is immigration. I've been through this.
I think she passed a red light or something, and they pulled over.
Yeah.
They pulled her over, and they got her identification,
sure,
and locked her up, and that was it. And so, you know, it's not that she couldn't come back. We paid up to $8,000. Okay. We had, my mother-in-law, her mom flew all the way down there because a funeral, there was a funeral she had to go to. So she went all the way over there and told her, well, come on, let's go. We're going back to Houston, to America. She says, no. My mother-in-law pleaded with her, you have kids over there. And so, like, you know, me and my mother-in-law, we're on talking terms, but the way we were forced into relationship, we were boyfriend and girlfriend at first, and what happened is that her mom didn't like that she had skipped school. So when she had skipped school, the school called the house, and I told my wife, her name is Heidi, I want to meet your parents. So on this particular day, I'm going to meet her parents. But we did not know that the school had already called her house. So as we come out of the trailer, we're walking down across the street, and there was this truck. He had a homemade camper in the back made out of wood. And her mom was standing right there looking through the window, looking right at us where we came out of. And so as soon as we walked past her, so aha, boy, she scared the living deep out of me. And so my wife, she turns around. I'm like, man, I'm going to go. She was like, nah, come on, you're coming with me. You want to meet my parents. So her mom's talking Spanish, and I knew a little bit of Spanish. And so we're walking. She's holding my hand. We walked all the way over there because they lived in a dead-end area, dead-end street. So we would get to her house and everything. I'm standing outside while she goes inside to go talk to her mom. Her mom starts getting after her and everything, and her mom told her that the school called and everything and said, you want to skip school? You want to miss school? You want to go out with them? You know what? Get your stuff and get the hell out of here.
Now, this is before there were kids.
Yes, sir. Okay. And so she comes out. I'm sitting down on the bumper. I don't know whose car it was. I'm sitting down on the bumper. And she comes out there, and she got tears in her eyes, and she stands in front of me. I go, what's wrong? She said, my mom kicked me out. I'm like, what? She goes, yeah, she kicked me out. I'm like, well, you got a friend, someone you can go to? And she was like, nah, I don't know what to do. I said, well, you know what? get all your stuff.
All of a sudden, you got responsibility.
Exactly. You know, I told her, well, you know what? Get all your stuff and let's go.
When did the kids start coming?
Well, they came after we were married. I had already told my wife I had a son. Mm-hmm. And this was back when I was 14.
Yeah.
And I told my wife that if we have kids, I don't want her to take my kids out of my life. Because the first time and the last time I got to see my son, my first son, was at his funeral.
Mm.
And I had got locked up and everything. Long story short, the baby was born when I was locked up as a juvenile. And when I got out, friends in the neighborhood was telling me, yeah, you got a baby with so-and-so. And when I finally contacted her, she said, I don't want to see you. My parents, they got a restraining order, so you're going to have to convince them to let you see the baby. So when I was able to set up a date to see the baby. It was going to be for Christmas Eve, and New Year's. And they'll pick him up the day after New Year's. Well, I get a phone call. I'm babysitting my friend's kids. I get a phone call at his house from the hospital saying that we need the father's permission to operate because the guardians, her grandparents, were not capable in giving the authority because they were drunk.
Sure.
So I'm like, well, yeah, sure. You know, what hospital this is? And, well, sir, first we need your permission to operate, sir. Yes, yes, yes. So I gave him my permission. They gave the phone over to someone else, and I talked to them. And I go, what hospital is this? And such. And so they gave me the information. I grabbed my homeboy's kids. I jumped in the car, and I got the cell phone. I said, hey, man, I'm going to the hospital. My son's there. I'm going to take your kids with me. So by the time we get to the hospital, my son only lived 5 minutes after the operation. He had swallowed a piece of glass the size of a nickel, and it got lodged in his throat. And so he passed away.
Just a kid.
Yeah, just a kid. And the only thing what pissed me off was at his funeral, you know, I prepared everything. I did everything for the funeral. And what pissed me off is that when we were leaving already going, we were walking, me and my homeboy and my best friend, she was a girl, she was my best friend, we're walking. She comes running and she looks at me and she goes, hey man, what's up? Long time no see. She gives me a hug and everything. And she goes, what's wrong? Why are you crying? She puts her hand on my chin like that and picks up my head. Why are you crying? I said, because man, lost my son. She goes, don't worry, we can always have another one. I looked at her and you know what I'm saying? And so my homeboy...
That's not exactly what you wanted to hear at the time.
Exactly. And so my homeboys, they jumped on me and they tackled me. They got me down. They go, nah, man. So my homegirl told her, beep, you better get the beep away from here because if they don't let him up, I'm going to do you. So she left. And that day since, I never did see her. I moved out of the neighborhood. And so when my cousins came to get me from living with my sister, I went to go live with them. I didn't have no girl in my life. And so I was real close to my cousins. And so a lot of people thought that didn't know me, they thought that I was my cousin's boyfriend. Because we know we were smoking weed, drinking. When they have parties, I'm over there kicking it with her because I was overprotective with my female cousins and with my sisters. And so we were over there drinking beer, smoking, and they were like, damn man, who's that? Oh man, it's my cousin. Oh, okay. Well, when that happened, they kicked my girlfriend out of the house. I grabbed her stuff, and we started walking back to the trailer. So my cousin, she was taking a shower. So when she comes out of the shower, we're sitting down in the living room watching TV. My cousin comes out. Her name is Trisha. She said, man, girl, I thought you were supposed to go home. And so she looks at me, and I go, hey, that's what I want to talk to you about.
This is on.
Her mom kicked her out. Can't she stay here? She was like, well, shit. She's already here.
Now, you got to watch the language a little bit.
Excuse me.
I'm in radio. I got to caution you.
It slipped. I was like, well, crap, you know. She's already here. So I was like, well, is it cool? She was like, yeah, you're going to have to get a job. I'm like, well, yeah, that's mandatory. And so I started working and everything. Well, a couple of weeks later, one thing led to another. It took me almost 6 months just to get a kiss.
Oh, okay.
It took me a year and 6 months just to get, you know, first base.
Yeah.
It just so happened that the amount of time I wasn't used to spending my time with just one girl. And so she broke that habit for me. I was with no one else but her.
Okay.
And so that one time was the only time, and she got pregnant by my son. And we didn't know this. So I'm working and everything, and I go to work, and I'm coming back from work. And when I come back from work, my cousin, her house was right next door to the trailer. It was just a fence that split us.
Mm-hmm.
So they come and they talk to my wife and everything, and they talk to my cousin, her sister, her little sister. And so they said, like, hey, man, what's up? You want to drink a couple of beers? Yeah, what's, you know, whatever, yeah. So I go over there, and we're kicking it. So my other cousin, Roxanne, her and my wife were going to go to the store, go get some more beer. So we stayed there, me, my cousin Roxanne's husband, and his brother-in-law, we stayed there. So we're just kicking it, catching up on, you know, ball game and stuff like that. And so my cousin and my wife, they pull back up into her driveway, the house, my cousin's driveway, and she's crying. And so my cousin, like, hey, man, she's seen her brother. I don't know what up, you know, something. They were talking about something. So I go there and I hold my wife, hey, what's wrong? I didn't know that I was a father yet. I don't know what's wrong. She was like, I see my brother. Well, what do you say? Well, he said that he's going to come over here and beat the crap out of you. Yeah, whatever, man, whatever. And so my cousin, she heard, you know, because my wife had already told her. So she went and told her husband. Her husband went and told her brother. And she told her sister, Trish. Trish told her boyfriend. Her boyfriend went across the street and told his uncle. So they planned everything. The guy that testified against me, Elizar Mendoza, he went and told his uncle, and his uncle was sitting outside on the porch, right? He can see the porch of the trailer. So he's sitting down on the porch with the lights off, with the 12 gauge. My Roxanne, her husband, he went to go get his 380, and his brother went to go get his 380.
You're building an army.
Well, you know, they're trespassing. It's private property.
Okay.
And so, you know, the thing
is, just ass whooping at worst.
Well, see, but the thing is that I was a minor. I was only 15 years old. So the thing is that he's going to come and beat the crap out of a minor when it's already understood. We just only gave his sister a place to live.
Mm-hmm.
So why does he want to take it out on us when it wasn't our fault? It was his mom's fault.
Yeah, sure.
And he want to come and take it out on me just because I was the choice of his sister's life. And so, you know, we're kicking it, everything, and it started getting late.
Patrol officers, my stations. This is not cop time. This is not cop time.
And so, time passed and everything. We started running out of beer. So, my Roxanne's husband and her brother, they went on to go get some more beer. So, you know, I wasn't an alcoholic, and I'm not an alcoholic. I'll drink one or two beers, maybe a six pack. And so, we're right there kicking it. And so I go inside. I had not taken a shower when I came back from work. So I go inside and I tell my wife, I want to take a shower. So we're boyfriend and girlfriend, common law married. So she's ironing my clothes. And while she's ironing my clothes on the sofa, she's ironing my clothes, and I'm sitting down talking to her, you know, letting her what's tomorrow, what I got to work on tomorrow and stuff like that, how much I should get my paycheck tomorrow and stuff like that. You know, what does she want to buy, if she needs anything? And there's a knock on the trailer door. So her brother, he's about that taller than me. And so there's a knock on the door, and the porch, you come up to the stairs like that, and then it got to the rail right here. So the door of the trailer, it opened up this way. So when I looked through the peephole, I couldn't see nobody because he's real short. Not only that, but he's standing off to the side. So when I opened up the door, I go, hey, what's up? You know, I kind of backed up a little. And she goes, who is it? I said, it's your brother. So she put the iron down and jumped up and ran over there. And so I went back to Arnon. She started talking to him. I went back to Arnon, and I could hear where they're talking, and he tells her, man, get out of the way. So I'm ironing my clothes, you know, getting ready to go take a shower. And I see his feet right up underneath me. And you're like, so what's up, man? So I put the iron down and I turn around. When I turn around, boom, he punches me. So instead of me going in with the punch, I went back and I flipped over the sofa. So when I flipped over the sofa, he knows about my family, and he knows that we don't take kindly to strangers. So he took off running. So when he took off running, my wife split. I ran out, you know, because I had promised my wife right there and then not to lay a hand on him. She asked me not to lay a hand on him. So I took the sucker punch. I had to. That was my wife's. She ran the house, and she still does. She gave me that order not to put my hands on him, and I didn't. So when he sucker punched me, I flipped over the sofa. I went to go call my cousin. When I called my cousin, everybody came running. He took off. Him and his brother-in-law took off in his mini truck. And so everybody was like, man, what's up, man? Where was everybody at? So Elizar Mendoza, his uncle.
And you're about 14 then?
Yes, sir. Elizar Mendoza, his uncle, his wife came to get him, take him inside, eat supper. My cousin's husband and his brother, they went to go buy some beer. So nobody was there. And so they left. And so I break down, man, my wife. They're like, and he took her, And then that's what my cousin says, and she's pregnant too. What?
It's the first you had.
I look at my cousin, I go, what? Yeah, she's pregnant. Man, I started breaking down crying because, like, man, she's pregnant. She didn't tell me, and he goes and kidnaps her because that's what his whole intention was, to come and split us up because he didn't want us. I guess he didn't want her to get pregnant, or he didn't want us to be together. So I thought that he had took her. So I'm like, man, I'm mad. My cousin, she was like, come down. My other cousin, he was over there, Raymond. All three of my cousins were there, and Roxanne's husband was there. So they're like, man, just chill, man, just chill. So they go out to the street, and they got their guns, and they're looking. And they don't see nobody. Until finally, we see the mini truck come back. And so the mini truck, it got them air hydraulics. Mm-hmm. So it comes, and it kind of slows down. And instead of it was dropped down, he picked it up all the way up and tilted to the side. So if any gunshots were going to be fired, it would hit nothing but the metal. And so he turned down their street where his mom lived. And going back there, right at the corner from his mom's house, lives his brother-in-law's parents' house. And there's a trail going through their yard all the way to the next street over to his house. So my wife said that's what he did. He took that trail to his house so he wouldn't have to go all the way around. So my cousin Roxanne, you know, she was like, man, you can't stay here. And then all of a sudden my wife shows up. So when she shows up, I pick her up and I'm carrying her. And her feet weren't touching the floor. I'm carrying her. So they told me put her down because they said that the first months of her pregnancy,
sure,
it's you got to be real careful.
Mm-hmm.
So I put her down, and then my cousin tells, you know, I asked Lorraine, where were you? I was hiding underneath the trailer. So my cousin says, y'all can't stay here. Where do y'all want to go stay at? I'm like, I don't care. So that's when my sister said, we can go stay at your sister's. So my cousin, she took us to my sister's, her and her husband. So we got in the car. Before us going over there, her husband wanted to go see where this guy was at that punched me, because he had not seen him before. So he wanted to get a look at him in case he'll see him later on, they can handle up. And so he drives down the street where my mother-in-law lives at, and he was sitting on the porch. And so he looked at him, and his wife, my cousin, said, no, let's go. So we left. They took me all the way to Houston to my sister's house. So they explained it to my sister. My sister and her husband said, yeah, you can stay here. So we lived there for a little while. Long story short, her mom found out where we were living. and said, look, I don't want this. I don't want this animosity between y'all kids and my kids. Will y'all be willing to get married? She goes, y'all, if y'all get married, y'all can come and live with me, and ain't nobody can tell y'all nothing. I looked at my wife, and I go, you gonna tell her? And she was like, well, Mom. She told her she was pregnant. And she was like, well, even now, y'all gonna have to get married. And I told, you know, I sat down with her mom, and I told her, I said, no, I made a commitment to your daughter the day you kicked her out, not to leave her without a roof over her head. And now your son wants to come and invade my territory, trespass on our property without our permission, and assault me, and then want to tell me what to do when it's already understood when I took your daughter from the get-go, when you pushed her out on the street. She's already living with me. She got new clothes. She has everything she needs. I got a job. So why do I still gotta keep on putting up with this nonsense? I'm only a kid, I can only do so much. And she said, well, look, she explained to me that one of her friends has known my wife since she was little and would be willing to pay the money for the marriage license if we would be willing to get married. So I turned around and got down on my knees and I asked my wife, would she marry me right there in front of her mom? And, you know, her first question, are you just only saying that because my mom's telling you to? And I'm like, nah, it's seriously. And she said, yeah. So my mom and her mom, they got together on a certain day. We went down to the courthouse and got the marriage license. So I think at that time it was $50. So we got the marriage license and we went, and the pastor of my older sister's church, he married us at my sister's house. And we've been married since. And up to today, we're still legally married.
She's where?
In El Salvador.
Where are all your kids?
Here in Texas.
In
Houston.
Because the family's still kind of split up.
Well, due to this case here, it split my family into three. Well, really into four, because my mom, she isolated herself from all of us. On May the 21st or the 22nd. No, I think it was after that. I got to visit my sisters, my two sisters and their kids. They came up here and visited me. Don already knew about the news. So after that visit, a couple of days later, my sisters, they took the day off of work to go talk to my mom. And they told my mom, hey, we got some news to tell you. Well, what is it? Son got a date. And the first thing that came out of her mouth was, well, I can't help y'all pay for the funeral. And my little sister, she's, how can I say it? Kind of like me. She's real, gets mad real easily. And told her, well, look, we're not here to ask you for any money. We're here to tell you that your son has a date. We want you in his life. He wants you in his life. Do you want to be here for his last days? And she wasn't trying to hear.
It didn't work.
And so my sisters, they said, okay, look, you know what? I'm through arguing with you.
But your sister stayed.
My sisters, they're still here.
She brought three of your children.
They're still here. Well, right now, I have three children. Two from my wife from El Salvador and one from my girlfriend. And it was a very tough thing and having to break the news to my kids.
Oh, sure.
And I didn't want no one else to tell them. I wanted to be the one to tell them. So my daughter, my 16-year-old daughter, she took it very well. I can see her eyes getting all teary, but she didn't cry. My son, he just couldn't take it because, you know, he's like, Dad.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not old enough to
but
be.
But he's only seen you through this glass.
Exactly. Well, see, I was out there for my son.
Yeah, in the beginning.
And the only two, my two daughters, I was never there for them. I've been locked up since I was 18 years old. So I grew up in here.
How past your 18th birthday were you when this happened?
Over maybe 6 months, 7 months.
So you were in the middle of the year.
Yeah, well, the...
Don't you find that setting dates, you can execute people, they did something before 18, but you can't after they're 18. It's pretty arbitrary, pretty...
Well, see, there was a couple of years ago, when my first years here, they were doing something in the courts where they were trying to file where a juvenile, his mind is not developing until the age of 26.
Because, you know, I run in a bunch of lawyers.
Exactly. And they were trying to pass that ruling that a juvenile, his mind does not stop developing until the age of 25, 26. Mm-hmm. And from what I heard, that they shot it down, that they denied it, and it wasn't going to be no show.
It'll be brought back up. I don't know when. I don't know if it's going to help you or not. But we've run out of time. Our interview is over. Mm-hmm. Any last word that you need to get out there?
I want to let my children know that I love them, I care for them. It hurts to have to tell them goodbye in this situation, and I was never there for them, but spiritually and physically, I'll always be there. Just look for the sky, look for the stars, and turn to my family.
That was the interview with Juan Garcia. It was recorded just a couple of weeks ago. Mark and I and Elizabeth went up and spent some time with him. The deal with the interview is he can talk about anything he wants to on the interview. It will not be edited or cut in any way for the broadcast, and that it will be broadcast on this show, and it will be broadcast on the videotape on Houston Media Source, and that's happened. We're waiting on Suzanne to give us a call and tell us where the Houston Vigil is, but Jennifer Simmons is supposed to give us a call and tell us where Houston Vigil is. Jennifer, is that you? Jennifer?
Yes, Ray.
Okay, where are you?
Well, I'm in my car now, but we did have a vigil today at the corner of Holcomb and Alameda. I'm sorry I didn't get the memo for the new protocol, but we had 5 women here at that corner. It's one block from the VA hospital and on the edge of Herman Park.
Yeah, because I'm going regularly to the VA hospital with friends these days. I pass that intersection frequently. It's there at next to the Dominican Sisters sign.
Exactly. There's construction there, but it's a very busy corner. We had good reactions from passers-by. We had 2 Dominican Sisters, 2 Texas Coalition to Abolish, and a person from Amnesty International. And so we just want to offer our grave sympathies to the family of Mr. Juan Garcia and, of course, to Hugh Solana.
Well, we have not heard back from Huntsville yet. I suspect we will do that any minute now.
I just got a notice through a news feed of mine that the execution had taken place.
The execution is complete. The process
yes,
is over.
I got that through the Houston Chronicle.
Okay, so we'll all read Gray's article when he posts it.
Yes, exactly, and we could probably predict what he would say, and we could write it for him.
Okay, thank you. I appreciate your calling, Jennifer.
Thank you, Ray. I'm so sorry I came at the tail end.
That's all right. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Jack, how important is the psychologist in these cases?
Well, the psychologist can be critical. One of the special issues that you have to answer before you get to the death penalty is whether is the prediction of future dangerousness. Psychologists can come in for the state and argue that the defendant, the defendant is going to pose a future dangerousness, and that's something that the state would bring up, and the defense would use also a psychologist to say, well, in fact, in the future, the defendant won't pose a future dangerousness, and what both sides are trying to do is give the jury information to sway the jury to agree or disagree as to future dangerousness.
And there were some problems with that testimony?
Sure. There were some problems with a particular psychologist by the name of Kahan. He, in fact, several on seven other death penalty cases, Kahan had testified for the state, and the because of his testimony, the state came back, the attorney general came back and said, we're real uncomfortable with his testimony. We'd like a do-over on the trial. And it didn't work. That wasn't the case here in Garcia's case, because Kahan testified for the defense rather than for the state. So the state had no reason to come back and say, well, we're uncomfortable with what Kahan said, and so we'd like a do-over. Specifically what Kahan's...
lost me somewhere. Kahan testified for the defense.
In this case, in Garcia's case, Kahan testified for defense.
But what he testified to did not work toward the defense.
It did not. It really didn't. But defense decided to use him anyways. Kahan, on seven other instances, had testified for the state, and the attorney general's office said, we're uncomfortable with what he said.
That dealt with predictability, future dangerousness, based on race?
Based upon race, among other things. Ethnicity, race, economics, but really what they zeroed in on was race and ethnicity as a predictor of future dangerousness.
Well, what was the defense lawyers thinking about?
That's a good question. I'm not real sure about that.
If this guy has a history that is so severe that Texas attorney generals, who are rather fond of executions themselves, want to go back and redo a bunch of trials.
You know, Ray, in this case, I'm not sure.
Are they not paying attention?
That may be the case, but I think in this case, in Garcia's case, in a span of a couple of months, there were seven aggravated robberies. The series of crimes that Garcia went on it's going to be real hard to convince a jury that he's not going to be a future danger. He committed all of these crimes, but he's not going to be a future danger.
It was an uphill battle in the
beginning. Was always going to be an uphill battle with Garcia.
Yeah.
It was always, and you know, if you think about it, you've already got a jury who doesn't like you. You've already got a jury who's decided to convict you of a capital murder. It's going to be real hard to convince them that, even though you hate me, here's a reason why you shouldn't hate me that much. It's going to be real hard. It's always an uphill battle. This question of future dangerousness, the special issues that are given to the jury, it's always an uphill battle for defense.
Did you hear what Breyer said on television this weekend? Were you paying attention, ears to the ground?
No.
Justice Breyer, mm-hmm. who is a Supreme Court justice, seems to be ready to reconsider.
Well, Scalia, not that long ago, in the last week or two, said that he wouldn't be surprised. And keep in mind, Scalia is a very, very conservative member of the Supreme Court.
Yeah, he was the guy that predicted gay marriage, by the way. Then.
Yeah, well.
Sometimes from the other side you can get echoes.
Well, Scalia has a tendency to want to leave people alone.
I know.
I
got his vote in Hill versus Houston.
Uh-huh.
He said, yeah, you can call that cop something that has to do with his mama and get away with it. Yeah. That's the way that works.
Yeah.
Do you think we're going to be out of this business?
I'd be shocked if we weren't. I would be shocked if we weren't.
Want to put a estimate time?
3 years.
3 years?
Yeah. I think 3 years.
All right. Put that on your record. Jack Lee, a conservative Republican Asian fellow, said three years and we're out of here.
I'm conservative all the time. I'm Republican some of the time.
Oh, okay. Gotcha. I appreciate the credit. You've been listening to the execution of Juan Garcia. Juan was an entirely likable interview. He is now dead. I have been informed by both my producer and the vigilant leader calling in from the Dominican sisters that the process is over. Juan's dead, and I don't think the world is greatly improved because of his absence. I know that his kids, and there seem to be a bunch of them, and I know that his wife in El Salvador has got to build a life again. It's not the first time. All I can do is say thank you to Jim Skelton, and thank you to Susan Ashley, who was in the studio. Thank you to Larry Douglas, who did the billboard in the first. Thank you, Mike Gillespie and Jack Lee. I can say thank you to Pat Hartwell in Huntsville, and I can say thank you to Jennifer Simmons, who was at the Houston Vigil, for giving us a report. I can say thank you, much thank you, to our producer, Elizabeth Stein. She makes all this possible. Texas is scheduled to kill Licho Escamilla coming up next round. That's due later this month, October the 14th, the day after my birthday. I can thank you to Robert Gardner and to Sharon McClutchy. And I can say thank you to Otis McClay for the wonderful work he does. And you're listening to Victoria Panetti, whose brother made some news from death row just this week. My name is Ray Hill. Execution Watch goes to rest.
Of Texas, children of God.